will first discuss an example. And it will be a somewhat non-trivial example because you consider the case k equal to 3. So the situation is that we have an overlap of this form. Okay, so we have p of these intersect. And as we have discussed for we will come back to this. So we have three things overlapping. We call alpha, beta, gamma. And we will try to determine what we have to integrate over alpha, beta, and gamma separately, what we have to integrate over these subspaces, the boundary subspaces, and what we have to integrate over this co-dimensional subspace. So let me begin by describing what we have to integrate over alpha because that's the simplest. So the choice of the PCOs and to simplify notation, I'll use this notation. The y of z is chi of z minus delta of z. And notice that the y's all commute to each other. Chi, of course, is mosaic. Okay, it's Q commutator, anti-commutator with psi. Okay, Q is formulaic, psi is formulaic. Okay. Here, delta is formulaic. Okay, so if you can imagine that you have delta of z1, delta of z2, that's not the same as delta of z2, delta of z1, the minus sign. But because of this dz, you have dz1 by dz2, right? That's the same as minus dz2 by dz1. So when you think of this as a one unit, this commutes with a similar object, divided by some other z, simply because there is a change of sign because of the z's getting permuted and the change of sign because of the dz's get permuted. Okay, so y is, so that means when you write the product of y's, it doesn't matter in which order you write the product of y's. So far, what we have to integrate over alpha, beta, and gamma, which will consume in alpha, okay, using the notation. So this is an n form on this. And this is, of course, just omega n. So omega n, but restricted to this is a pullback of omega n. And in pulling it back, you need a section, so that will use the section z1 alpha, z2 alpha, z3. So, okay, so each dzi alpha, dzi, y, let me write omega expression. So, omega expression, let me remind you that it will be on the form of y is z1 alpha, y is z2 alpha. These are all wave products, which O, and then pull out the n form. Okay. What is O? O is sum over k, 0 to infinity, ds1, ds1. And it's understood that all of these are calculated in the local coordinate system that we have introduced, which is also part of the data for the local section. Okay, so essentially, when you pull back omega, you have to use the sections Z1 alpha, Z2 alpha, Z3 alpha. Okay, for the PCO locations, and of course, all the local coordinate choice will also be induced from whatever section you have chosen here. Okay, that choice of section is continuous across the boundary. When you're assuming that that choice of local coordinates jump across the boundary. Okay? What jumps across the boundary is only the Z's, the PCO locations. Yeah, well, you can take k from 0 to infinity, but of course, more than n, it will not continue. Right? But this is a general definition of O. Okay, so you can use this O to define any P form.
Just want to get to be clarified. Suddenly the PCO location is jumped across those lines.
Yes.
But the other boundary lines don't change across the lines, is it?
See, this is the modulized space, right? So the coordinates of M, G, M, N are changing continuously across the space. And as you are moving in this, right, the coordinates of M, G, M, N are changing continuously. What jumps is the section that you have chosen, right? And that section data, okay, this is the jump. So here, of course, you are moving continuously. Okay? So here, you are changing from one section to another section. But we are assuming that the section contains two sets of data, right? One is the local coordinate system, the other one is the PCO location. The local coordinate systems are still continuous across. It's only the PCO location is here. Okay? And it's not enough to say that the PCO locations are jumping, it's not enough to say what condition of the final PCO location is at. You have to also specify the path. So for every pair alpha beta, so for every pair alpha beta, we specify the path along which the zeta I alpha is zeta I beta. Okay, and this path, this ordering could be different for different pairs. Okay, for alpha beta, you may choose one ordering, for beta gamma, you may choose another ordering. Okay, it's completely up to you. Okay, so you have to do it for every pair. But once you have done it for alpha beta, beta alpha will be exactly the opposite order. Okay, it doesn't make sense to specify separately for beta alpha. Okay, because you have the PCO data on alpha, PCO data on beta, and you are saying what path it takes. Okay, that is very specifying this more accurately by saying what various segments it got. Is this clear?
No,
QB is partner also.
Oh,
we have six ideas partner, okay? So that's why guys are who's are they?
But there is also which product we call
the but guys have zero forms. The zero form commutes with everything, right? And the right. Okay? Because there are one forms, right? They add the forms. Is this okay? Okay, so you have to fix a convention. And you fix a convention that as you move from alpha to beta for this particular situation, as you move from alpha to beta, you first move Z1, then Z2, then Z3. Okay, that is the convention we will be using. Similarly, the same convention we will be using for beta to gamma and from gamma to alpha. Okay, it's a specification of the section. Okay, what it specifies? What these vertical segments are, okay, as you are moving. But it's not necessary, let me repeat again, that you should change the same description for moving from alpha to beta and from beta to gamma. Okay. For beta to gamma, you could have moved Z2 first, then Z1, then Z. Okay, that's perfectly possible. So this means that the path to alpha beta is in the notation that I used earlier, is the path 000 to 100 to 110 to 111. Okay? Because 0, 0, 0 means all z alpha, z1 alpha, z2 alpha, z3 alpha. 1, 0, 0 means this is z beta 1, z alpha 2, z alpha 3. This will be z beta 1, z beta 2, z alpha 3. And then finally you move to z beta 1, z beta 2, z beta 3. So mu alpha beta n minus 1. This is integral about mu alpha beta omega. So the reference from mu n minus 1. This is an n form. Then we have to integrate over this one cycle to get to n minus 1. Okay. I am not being very careful about the signs, okay, but this you can easily figure out. If you go to the conventions appropriately, you can figure out the exact sign that you have to use there. But by its sign, you can see that this is given by psi z alpha 1. Z beta 1. See, each term, the product, will contain one instance of Z1, one instance of Z2, one instance of Z. Okay, there are three pieces. What difference is whether you are using the Z for alpha or Z for beta. The second term will be xi of z2 alpha and xi of z2 alpha. This time, this is the segment. This is so, this takes care of this segment. Okay, 0, 0, 0 to 1, 0, 0.
Z1 alpha minus z1 beta or z1 beta minus z1 alpha?
Okay, as I said, the sign you have to figure out, there is a, because there is a minus sign here.
Oh.
Right, it's z1 alpha minus z2 beta, but there is another minus sign because del q alpha beta is supposed to be the minus the boundary, right? So you just look at this. So del q alpha beta gamma, the alpha to alpha n was given by q alpha 1 to what is that? Q alpha naught to alpha n minus 1 minus q alpha naught to alpha n minus 2 alpha n and so on. Okay? Using this you can figure out, okay, whether the boundary of q is the difference between the end point and the beginning point or the beginning point of the end point. Okay? That will determine the limits of it. But there is one minus sign that is coming from here. Okay, so as I said, I have not been careful about the sign, but you can easily figure out by using the relations that I gave. The boundary of q, what is the boundary of q? Okay. If it is this, that means that this is the end point of the contour, this is the beginning point of the contour. Okay, so del q alpha beta will be something like q alpha minus q beta. Or q beta minus q alpha, that you have to figure out from the side. So once you figure that out, you know the beginning and the end points, and you can work this out. Is this clear? If you tell me from the notes what the sign was, I can tell you right now what it is. Right? Was it like this? How del q alpha 0 to alpha and what is the formula?
Yes, the formula is we wrote it with summation. Yeah.
Yes.
So the first term was
alpha beta gamma, it was all minus q alpha beta.
Yeah, so there was a minus 1 to the power k minus i, right?
Yes. And there was an overall minus sign in front of the sign.
Yeah, and an overall minus sign. So minus 1, so I is equal to k, that's this term. Right? When I equal to k, because that I term is missing. Right? Yes. Sorry, the alpha k. So that means the del q, q alpha beta would be minus of q alpha minus q beta, right? So the overall minus sign is there. Then in the first term, you drop the last index. Okay, because minus 1 to the k minus I, so this is I equal to k alpha, and then you drop the first index. So this is q beta minus q alpha. So integral is being done from q alpha to q beta, right? That is m alpha to m beta. Okay? That is alpha to beta. But there is a minus sign. Because of this minus sign, okay, it becomes a bit from beta to alpha. That's why we have xi of z1 minus alpha minus xi of z1. This case, this you have to work out carefully, including all the signs, but it's straightforward to figure out what the signs are. And the final one will be xi of z3 alpha minus xi of z3 beta 1 of z1 beta 1 of z3 2 beta, and the whole thing will be whole square. And you have to then pick the n minus 1. Is this clear? This is analog of this we had done earlier, because this is still not the complicated part of the story, right? Because it's jumping. So basically, the first term is the result of moving from 000 to 100. So the first argument is changing. Second and third arguments are fixed at 0. Right? That means at z1, z alpha. And that's why it's y of z2 alpha, y of z3 alpha. Then in the second part of the jump, in the second argument that is changing, okay, that's why it's xi of z2 alpha minus xi of z2 beta. The first argument is fixed at 1, right? Which means beta. Okay, that's why y of z1 beta. But the third argument is fixed at 0, okay, that's y of z3 alpha. And finally, this motion, okay, third argument is changing, that's here. And then the first two arguments are fixed at beta. Is this clear? So this gives you mu r n minus 1 alpha beta. Similarly, mu n minus 1 beta gamma and mu n minus 1 gamma. Okay, all you have to do is just set change alpha beta to beta gamma and alpha beta to gamma alpha in this equation. Okay, because the paths are the same. Okay, you move 1 first, 2 next, and 3 last. However, mu n minus 1 beta alpha, this is not obtained by simply extending alpha and beta. Okay, because the path from beta to alpha is different, right? It's an opposite order. So this in fact is minus mu n minus 1 alpha. Okay, because it's the opposite path. Right? You are integrating over the same subscript and opposite direction. Okay? Or if you don't like this, you can work out explicitly by following exactly the same rules. Okay? But now you change from beta to alpha, but in the order that you move this one first, then this one, then this one.
I think extending beta alpha will give you this one.
Will give you? No, extending beta alpha will not give you this one. If you extend beta and alpha here, you will not get the same answer.
Now here, you will then take 3 per part, then the 2, then the 1.
Exactly. Okay. See, if you extend beta and alpha here, right, this will change sign. This will change sign, right? But these will become beta 1.
Yes.
Right? That's not negative of what you have here, right? So negative of what you have here is just put a minus sign. So this will become xi of z1 beta minus xi of z1 alpha. But when that movement is taking place, the other two are in alpha, not in beta. Whereas if you had changed, just extend beta and alpha, right? That's a different path. That's a path in which you go from 1, 1, 1 to 0, 1, 1, right? Because you are changing this z1 first, then to 0, 0, 1, and then to 0, 0, 0. Okay? That's not the opposite part of the path of this. Okay, so this you should keep in mind. That so mu alpha beta, okay. In order to define mu alpha beta, you have to specify a path from alpha to beta.
Sir, if you look at the last term, say xi of z3 alpha, xi of z3 beta.
Yes.
If you change alpha beta in back term, you see that it is z3 beta minus z3 alpha.
Yes, this some change this side.
And the z1 and z2 are left hand beta, which is means.
So these will become alpha. If you just exchange beta and alpha.
Oh, this will become alpha.
This will become alpha, right? That's not what you want, right? Yeah, so you have to keep this as beta.
Yes.
So you have to basically take the same expression and put a minus sign. Okay, not extend beta and alpha, because this formula that I gave, right, is not valid for arbitrary pair alpha beta. Okay? It's valid for those pairs alpha beta for which the path that I have chosen is this one. Right? If you take another pair alpha beta for there's a different path, you have to use a different expression. Right? So you fix the regions first, and then for every pair of regions, you put pick a path. Okay, only then you can write an corresponding expression.
So we don't have to symmetrize the z1, z2, z3 like we did for
no. Well, in z1, z2, z3, no, you don't have to. Okay. You could do that, but it's not necessary.
So if we did that, then I think just replacing alpha and beta.
Yeah, if you do that, then replacing alpha and beta will do the job. But then you have to satisfy many more conditions, right? Because if we also extend z1, z2, z3, right? So symmetrize, then you have many more corner points. Okay? If you just see, you have to put more conditions, you have to satisfy more conditions, which is okay because it's still a finite number of conditions, right? As long as there are codimension two subspaces, right? If any finite number of codimension two conditions leave enough space to put the BCOs, right? To avoid them in a given ratio. So you could symmetrize, but it's not necessary. Is this clear? Then you will symmetrize in the bound sense. But symmetrizing in the PCOs is not necessary. Although you could do that if you want.
The level of integrand, when we choose these paths, at the level of integrand before integration, this is dependent on the path.
Yes.
Only after doing the integration, we see that for on shell.
Yeah, exactly. Right. But otherwise, it depends on the path, but it's just choosing different sections, right? Different subspaces of PGML. So if you choose different subspaces of PGML, the result is supposed to be different, right? Off-shell results are certainly different. Even on-shell results, only after you have taken into account the total derivatives and the boundary terms and so on. Okay, so now we have to calculate mu alpha beta gamma. So what? So you have to construct then these bits need Q alpha beta gamma. Right? Because you have to integrate over Q alpha beta gamma. You have to take omega n and integrate over Q alpha beta gamma to. So this is the integral Q alpha beta gamma. Omega n. So to calculate Q alpha beta gamma, let's remind. Remember that del Q alpha beta gamma is the minus sign here. It is given by Q alpha beta plus Q beta gamma plus Q gamma alpha. Now we'll use the convention that the procedure that we described earlier. So you put alpha at 0, 0, 0, beta at 1, 1, 1, and gamma at 2, 2, 2. Okay? At three corners of the cube of length 2. And draw the path q alpha beta, q beta gamma, and q gamma alpha. So q alpha beta is this one. Yeah, this is the path q alpha beta, so on that big lattice of size 2, we write 0, 0, 0 to 1, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 0 to 1, 1. But now we have to append to this q beta gamma. Okay, beta to gamma, it follows exactly the same order. So you move 1 first, then 2, then 3. But this time we are moving from 1 to 2, right, not from 0 to 1. Okay, because the convention is that 0, 0, 0 is the alpha, 1, 1, 1 is the beta location, and 2 to 2 is the gamma. So now it will be.
Can you be confident about the notation?
Yes.
The first piece of q alpha beta,
yes,
will be like 0 0 0 minus 1 0 0. Second piece would be like 1 0 0 minus 1 1 0.
Yes.
Can you put them together? I mean, the pieces in between they appear twice. They are end point of some segment and starting point of some other segment as well.
Yes, that's right. So that's the idea, right? I mean the z1 alpha, this z1 alpha, sorry, this z1 beta is appearing here.
Yeah, this is right. I'm confident about that notation. I mean, they are appearing only once, like minus 1, 0, 0. But it actually appears in two segments of q alpha beta.
But this is the path, I'm right, right?
Arrow.
That is arrow.
Oh, okay.
No. Yeah. Then minus. Yeah. They're arrows. So now 1 1 1, the first one increases again, right? So this goes to 2 1, then 2 2 1, then 2 2 2. Yes, clear? Then q gamma alpha. Okay, now we are jumping from gamma to alpha. Gamma is 2, okay, alpha is 0. So again, the first one moves first, so 2 becomes 0. So 0, 2, 2. 0, 0, 2. So this is a closed path on that cube. Now our job is to find a two-dimensional surface bounded by this closed curve, okay, which of course always exists. Any closed curve is a trivial topology, okay? So there will be two-dimensional surface bounded by this. But you don't want an arbitrary two-dimensional surface, you want to build it out of faces, right? So that it's a sum of squares, okay, or sum of rectangles. So that on each rectangle only two of the coordinates, right? Okay, not all three. So the question is, given this dot, can you construct such square collection of rectangles? Now, if you just think of it geometrically, you can easily see that it's always possible to do this. Okay. Take any arbitrary surface and then smoothen it out. Okay, so that it goes along the faces of the rectangle. Because each of these are along the limits. Okay, that's necessary. Because each of these are along the limits, you can always take a subspace and basically deform it so that it starts lying along the faces. So what I will do is I will give a specific choice. Okay, the choice is not unique. Okay, just like the choice of path from alpha to beta was not unique, just like q alpha beta was not unique, q alpha beta gamma is also not unique here. But I will give you a choice. Q alpha beta is the what? Yes.
That will be
okay. Because k equal to 3, that will be, that is trivial to figure out. Okay, that I am not going to try to figure out, but you can easily do that. So Q alpha beta gamma. Okay. So claim. The Q alpha beta gamma is a union. So what is the strategy? So the strategy is that, so this is a closed path. We'll now write this, express this as a union of closed paths. So that each of those closed paths lie along a rectangle. Okay, then each of them will have a surface bound by it, right? Which is fx. So there will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rectangles. So 0, 1, 2. Third coordinate is fixed. So in the 1, 2 plane, it's 0, it starts from 0, 1, right? So 0, 1 is this one. So this is a 0. So it starts from here, then moves, 0 moves to 2, moves 2 units, then 1 moves to 2, okay, so this is a 1, 2 plane. Forget about the last one. 1, 2 plane. Okay, the shape is that this is 0, 1, this is 2, 1, this is 2, 2, and this is 0. This is kept, the third quadrant is always fixed, right? At 2. Okay, so this is the rectangle that it has in the 1, 2 plane, so that has a property that it lies around the face, right? Only 1 and 2 quadrants, right? Then 0, 0, 2. Okay, so you can also try to verify that at each of these one coordinate remains fixed.
Is always third coordinate fixed.
Pardon? Yes, third row.
No.
In the third row, the second one is fixed.
Yeah.
So the claim is that the sum of all these is this. Okay, so let's try to verify. Okay. So what you have to verify? You have to verify that for each link here, for each arrow here, there is an arrow there. And whatever is left there must cancel among themselves. Okay, that can be arrows going in both directions, so which cancel among themselves. Right? So let's try to 0, 0, 0 to 1, 0, 0, right? Let's see 0, 0, 0 to 1, 0, 0. Where is it?
Third line.
Yeah, third line. So this is one. Then 1, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 0. Fourth line. 1, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 0, right? And that's this one. Let me write numbers. This is 1, 1. This is 2. Okay, these two. That's it. This one, let's see. 1 1 0 to 1 1 1. Yeah, see here it's a combination of two paths. 1 1 0 to 1 1 2, and then 1 1 2 back to 1 1 1. See, these are along the same line, right? Only the third coordinate is changed, right? So 0 to 2 is changes, third coordinate changes, and then it changes back to 1. Okay, that's why.
Just have to see that which coordinate means fixed here and here. So.
Yeah, so two of them, as far as links are concerned, right? Each dot has two links fixed.
Yes, yes.
Right? So for example, if you had 1 1 0 to 1 1 2 and then the second one changes, then that's what you can just add.
Yes.
Okay? Here, because everything is moving in the same direction, you can add them, right? So 1 1 0 to 1 1 2 and 1 1 2 to 1 1 1. So these two together. Account for this one. Is this clear? Then because you are just taking a third coordinate, going from 0 to 2 and coming back from 2 to 1, right? So that part is that makes sense. Okay, now 1 1 1 to 2 1 1. That's here. (2 1 1 to 2 2 1) is there.
First line, last two are 0 2 2 2 0 1.
And
the first line, the
first part.
Oh, yeah. So this and this, right? Because
yeah.
2 is changing to 1 and then 1 is changing to 0, right? Everything else remains the same. So these two together gives the 8th one. Then 0 0 2 to 0 0 0.
Third line.
Third line is. So let's what is left. So 0 1 2 to 2 1 2. So you have to find the reverse path. Okay, 2 1 2 to 1 1 2, and then you have to find the 1 1 2 to 0 1. Yeah. So these two. See 2 1 2 to 1 1 2, and 1 1 2 to 0 1 2. All of them are the same thing, right? 1 and 2. Then the last two are fixed. Only the first one is same. So this. This cancels.
Is that you use a different color for canceling?
Different color for canceling?
It's
it's numbered anyway, so it shouldn't matter. (2 1 2 to 1 1 2) (1 1 2 to 0 1 2). So that should cancel from 0 1 2 to 2 1, right? So it is 10. Is this point clear? Yeah, it is exactly reverse, right? 1 into fix, 2 to 1, and then 1 to 0. They are the same answer. Then 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 2.
On the last line, there is a 2, 2, 2, 2, 2.
Yeah, so these stands. Zero zero two two one zero two. So we need a reverse one. 1 0 2 2 0. Yeah. So these. That's it. Then 1 0 2 2 1 1 2. This one, 1 0 0 2 1 0 2, is here.
That we have used before, right?
Which one?
1 1 2 2 1 0 2, we cancelled with 1 0 2 2 1 1 2.
No, I would have numbered it different. This one I didn't use that.
No, no, we can.
1 1 2 2 1 0 2. Which term did you cancel against? You can use
another.
This is number 10.
Oh,
yeah, okay. That's number 10. This one. This
yeah.
One. 2 1 1 2 2 1 2 is left, right? Yeah, so this is cancel. This and this. Okay, so now we have to just write down the corresponding expressions for the integrals of omega over these two-dimensional subspaces. So this minus sign will put back there. Or maybe I can just start with minus sign, yeah? So the first term, let's look at this. What will be the expression for this? So you are integrating del xi z1 dz1, del xi z2 dz2, because third one is fixed. And z1, okay, whether it's now, whether you put a z1 integral first or z2 integral first, that is dependent on which one is moving first. Right? Here, for example, the z1 is moving first, right, from 0 to 2. So you should think of it as dz1 plus z2. Okay, that will give the what integral. So z1 is moving from 0 to 2, which means from alpha to gamma.
You said that changing the order of y.
But now we are doing the integral. See, when we write a del xi1 dz1 with del xi2 dz2, it doesn't matter. Okay? But now I am pulling out dz1 dz2. Okay? I have to integrate over the z1 z2. Right? So there, whether you do the z1 integral first or z2 integral first makes a difference. Right? How you orient it? Okay? Because you are, as a form, it doesn't matter. Right? But now, to integrate over a given surface, you have to know the orientation of the surface. Right? If the surface orientation changes, the result will change by a sign. Okay. So what I am saying is that which one should be kept first, right? Whether dz1 should be kept first or dz2 should be kept first, is determined by which one moves first. Right? Here the z1 moves first, right? From 0 to 2. Okay. So dz1 is dz2 is what you have to think of. So I write this, so the, I think once I write this it will come here. So it should be xi of z1.
This
orientation minus because it's wedge
polar.
Yes. So this orientation minus because it's wedge polar. Yes, very sure. So this should be xi of z1 gamma minus xi of z1 alpha. Right?
Yes.
So it's going to 0 to 2. And z2 is moving from 1 to 2. So once you understand this, you know how to write the rest of the terms. Is the origin of this clear? The z1 is moving from 0 to 2, so alpha to gamma. Z2 is moving from 1. And z3 is remaining fixed at 2, that means gamma. Z3 is remaining fixed at z3 gamma. Right? That's why.
For the first error, why don't you have this xi factor as given the first one and then y of d2 beta, y of d3 gamma?
Because I have to integrate over a two-dimensional subspace, eh? The two-dimensional subspace is an integral in the z1, z2 plane. Okay? So I need to pick the dz1 versus dz2 factor. So you can use the y, right? But at the second step, you have to use that dz2 part of y. Yeah, and that's what I have done here. Right? I have done the two-dimensional surface integral at one go. Right? Thinking of the measure as del xi1 dz1 or is del xi2 dz2. Okay? The chi of z2 has no role to play. because the Z2, one of the carrying vectors is on del Z2, right? So you have to contract the dZ2.
So you have two factors of.
Yeah, so I have two factors of all, right? So that's why here I have to pick up n minus 2 form after I have done all that. Pardon? Z3 comma. Let's try to work on the next one. Then we can come. Yeah. So what should be the next factor?
Xi z1 beta minus xi z1 alpha.
Okay, so
that
xi z1.
See the second one also third is remaining things, right? So yeah, z1 beta minus z1 alpha, right? So xi z1 beta minus xi z1 alpha.
Same for z2.
Z2 is also between 0 and 1, right? Yeah. Z2 is going from 0 to 1. So xi z2 beta minus xi z2 alpha. And then y. Okay, because again the third one is fixed at 2. This one, the second one is fixed. Okay, second one is fixed at 0. Okay. And the first one is moving from 0 to 1, and the third one is moving from 0 to 2. Then last one, the fifth one, here the Z2 is kept fixed at beta, Z1 is moving from beta to gamma, and Z3 is also moving from beta to gamma. Okay? Right? We look at the last one first. Z2 is kept fixed at beta, which is true here. Yeah. V1 is 1. And then Z1 is moving from 1 to 2, that's from beta to gamma. That's what we have here. And Z3 is moving from 1 to 2 also. That's from beta to gamma. So the first one, Z1 is fixed at 2. Z3 moves from 2 to 1. Okay, let's see. No, so it's moving from 1 to 2, right? 2, 1, 1 to 2, 1. See, we just look at the first, right? And then of course there is a retard path. Okay, you decide because this DZ1 or DZ2 is basically the fact that if 1, 2, 3, 4, right? This is this, well, I can, I'm going to look oppositely. I mean, it's like if you have this. Right? That we think of as a positive orientation, right? Okay, anti-clockwise orientation. Right? So here, dz1 is dz2 integral over this. Okay, we will give you a positive answer. Right? That's the definition. Right? And that's what we are using. So the final one, z1 is fixed at gamma, z2 moves from 1 to 2. And Z3 also moves from 1 to 2, that's from beta to gamma. So this finishes the construction of mu n minus 2 alpha beta gamma. Okay. And now if you have three of these, not four of these meeting at a codimension 3 subspace, okay, that will be mu n minus 3 alpha beta gamma delta. Okay. What you have to do is that you have to now draw this on a the same 3 dimensional cube, but now the length will become 3. Okay. It will go from 0, 1, 2, 3. Alpha, beta, gamma, delta. We have a subspace Q alpha, beta, gamma, which is given by this. Okay, the volume that is bounded by this. Okay, similarly, we have a Q beta, gamma, delta, that is a parallel volume of similar type Q gamma, delta, alpha. Right? So you can collect all those volumes. Sorry, all those surfaces, not volumes. Right? These are binding surfaces. Right? So these surfaces will bind, will bound a volume. Right? And in three dimension, a volume is unique. Right? Once you specify a surface, there is a unique volume that is bounded by this. Right? There is an ambiguity on which surface, which subspace you choose. So that determines the Q alpha beta gamma delta unit. Is this clear? Right? If you have, see, just like in, yeah, so in three dimension, if you have three different two-dimensional subspaces, right? Not three, four different two-dimensional subspaces. We have alpha, beta, gamma, delta, gamma, delta, alpha, and then delta, alpha, beta. Right? These three under they together bind a three-dimensional column which is uniquely fixed, and that's what will determine Q alpha, beta, gamma. And then you integrate by following the similar. Any questions? So let me now briefly indicate the algorithm that one will follow. This is a general algorithm which will work in all cases. But then of course, depending on the situation, you will want to simplify things as much as possible, right? By reducing the number of patches on which you have to specify the PCO allocation field dependent. So the algorithm is the first we do a dual triangle. Okay? And we take this to be by small polynomial. Okay, and ideally, as long as the polyhedra is sufficiently small, this algorithm will always work. Okay, if the polyhedra becomes start becoming big, then sometimes it may fail. Okay, so but we can, so that determines how what size polyhedra you should take. Right? You want to simplify life because you want the polyhedra to be big, so that you have only a few things to specify. Then you don't have to specify the issue locations independently on any different patches. On the other hand, if you make them to be too big, okay, then you can avoid spurious poles, right? So you have to choose a balance. And that depends on the situation at hand. Then, so once you have chosen the dual triangulation, you have many M alphas, right? Many epsilon alphas. Okay, many different polyhedra. So choose some particular polyhedra. Choose some particular. And choose PCOs. And the fact that this can always be done, okay, you can see it intuitively in the following way. That take all possible choice of PCO locations. Okay, you have chosen some M alpha, take all possible choice of PCO locations. Which is some say 2k dimensional space. If there are a PCO location, it's 2k dimensional space, right? Because each PCO location is a complex coordinate. Now we know that there are co-dimensional two subspaces in this, right, which are bad. Okay, if you put a PCO there, you will find a singularity. So, there are these co-dimensional two subspaces which are threading, there are many such co-dimensional two subspaces. And the idea is that you have to pick a region of PCO locations which is outside this, which never intersect this co-dimensional two subspaces. And because you are looking at only a small region, you can always find some small region in the space of PCO locations where you can, which is sufficiently far away from all these co-dimensional. Because co-dimensional two subspaces form a set of either zero inside the possible choice of PCO. Right? You can always find choices which avoids these co-dimensional two subspaces where things are bad. So you could pick your PCO locations on M0 alpha that way. Okay? So after you have done that, we pick another M alpha. Another polyhedra. M naught beta. And do the same. But now we have potentially more constraints. The more constraint comes because if this polyhedra M0 beta share a common boundary with M0 alpha, then it is not enough that you choose the PCO locations in M0 alpha to avoid spurious poles. You also have to make sure that on the common boundary, there will be PCO locations, what you integrate will involve the PCO locations both from M0 alpha and M0 beta. And those corner points depend on both sets of PCO locations. So now the number of constraints that we have to satisfy is more. right? Because you have to satisfy the ray. Not only m naught beta by itself is split from spurious singularities, but also on the common boundary between m naught alpha and m naught beta, whatever you integrate should be free from spurious singularities. So that increases the number of conditions that you have to satisfy. But nevertheless, it still remains 4 dimensional 2. And hence, you can always satisfy, find appropriate choice of PCOs, okay, which does the job. And then you keep repeating this. And the main point is that as you keep repeating this, the number of conditions may go up, okay, for a given m naught alpha. But total number of conditions is always finite. Okay, because a given m naught alpha has overlap only to finite number of m naughts. Right? And so number of conditions that you have to satisfy at any given state, say that. So at any given state, what is the situation? That there are already some m alphas on which you have chosen your PCOs. Then you are not to change them. Given that choice, okay, you choose your new m naught alpha, okay, where you have not chosen the PCOs as yet. Okay? And there the choice of PCO is constrained. Not only by demanding that it should be free from spurious poles in the interior, but also that it should be free from spurious poles at the boundary, where it involves also exchange with the PCOs from the region across the boundary. But because there are always finite number of conditions, and because these conditions are always codimensional 2, you are guaranteed that you can always find a small region, find some region in the space of PCOs, where you can put the PCOs and you satisfy all the constraints. This is the reason that choosing these two sufficiently small is necessary. Right? That if you try to make them big, you may not be able to get away with it. Right? But as long as you choose them to be sufficiently small, this procedure should always work. Okay? Because you always are trying to satisfy a finite number of conditions. And a finite number of conditions can always be satisfied. The finite number of conditions, which each of which excludes a codimension 2 subspace, can always be satisfied, okay, in some finite region in the space of PCOs. Okay. So this is a general algorithm, but again, as I said, for practical calculations, if you are trying to do an analytic calculation, okay, of course you want to choose your PCOs cleverly so that you can get away with as little number of patches as you can. If you can find one patch, okay, where you can avoid spurious singularity altogether, that's the best. Okay? Then you don't have to take two patches, add corrections, and do what we guess. But once you go to sufficiently high genus, you have to do this. Right? You cannot really avoid having to choose patches and putting them together. Any questions? Okay, finally we will consider this question of blue incompatibility. This is a question which came up last time. So what we have described so far shows that you can choose your PCO locations, okay, at any given region in the moduli space in such a way so that you can avoid spurious poles, okay, by using these rules of orthogonal integration. But you don't have a complete freedom of choosing the PCO locations arbitrarily. Okay, earlier that introduced the notion of blue incompatibility, which means that if you take two Riemann surfaces for which you have already specified the PCO locations, and if you do a plumbing fixture, then for the plumbing fixture variable between 0 and infinity, you should use the same PCO locations that you have chosen originally. You cannot just make new choice of PCOs because there is a Feynman diagram interpretation in non-linearity. So now the question is that are we guaranteed that if we do this, right, if we choose the PCOs this way, that it as induced from the original surfaces, are we guaranteed that the new surface will not have any spill dressing? Okay, that is the question. So let me draw this figure. I am considering here a separating type Boolean relation, but it can be also applied to non-separating type. Right? So here you have some marginal surface, some vortex operators. And some PCOs, and we will draw them again by some different color chalk. So now we identify coordinates. Let's remove these punctures and identify coordinates around the punctures by using the standard notation, the W1, W2. So this is a C1. So how are you guaranteed that this happens when this P comes to the response? Now for this we have to recall that we had written down an expression for this amplitude in terms of the amplitudes in these surfaces. But that's the reason why how you could get a Feynman diagram. And so that expression took the following form. It took the form of the appropriate correlation function on sigma 1. Okay? Here the usual external vortex operator inserted here, the B ghosts are inserted and so on. And here we insert the state phi m, okay, which will be given to the sample word. Then similarly, there is a similar amplitude on sigma 2. So phi m is inserted here, phi n is inserted there on original sigma 1 and sigma 2. And then you have a propagator factor, which is phi m c. V0, V0 bar, L0 plus L0 bar, inverse delta, L0, L0 bar, phi n c. Okay, and you're supposed to sum over it. Is this clear? Now, by construction, these do not have any spurious relations. These are finite. Right? Because you have chosen the PCO locations for individual surfaces, so that applies all spurious. Okay, it doesn't matter what vortex operator you introduce here. Okay? The spurious locations for the spurious poles don't depend on what vortex operator you use. Okay, as long as there are minus one picture or minus half picture vortex operator, as we discussed. Yeah, in a normal case, okay, let me put this, I think I call this what? G. Okay. Where G is identity in NS and chi 0. Okay, but that is going to be important. Okay, it's not, if I just had identity, it wouldn't be equal to one. Now, if you recall, you also introduced the notion of scaling the local coordinates, that while choosing the local coordinates, so we had a choice of scaling them in such a way that there is an exponential suppression factor, okay, in these amplitudes of the form e to the minus s naught times h. your e to the minus x naught times h x, but these are the conformals. Right? I mean, this factor, you could have actually had it propagated, but you just absorbed it, you absorbed them in the vortex, right? So, I could have either said that this integral, right? See, this L0 plus L0 1 came from this 0 to infinity e to the minus S L0 plus L0 1, right? So, instead of 0 to infinity, if I had declared from S0 to infinity, right? It would have automatically given that e to the minus S0 times L0 plus L0 1, okay, which is the conformal of this field. But we had said that, okay, we will keep this as from 0 to infinity, but absorb the e to the minus s naught times hm into the definition of these. Okay, which can be done by just scaling the local coordinates and the functions appropriately. So the option is that you can choose the vortices, okay, you can choose the definition of these string field vortices in such a way that you can include suppression factors of the form e to the minus s naught hm and e to the minus s naught hn for arbitrary s naught. We can take s naught to be as large as n. So we can really make it subplace for large h. So this means what? That this means that for sufficiently large s naught, only a few terms are going to contribute to this sum. Then because the higher and higher HMs fall off very fast. And if only a few terms contribute to the sum, then, and if each of these are finite, then the result is also manifestly finite. Okay, because you simply cannot add finite terms, okay, and get an infinite result. Is this argument clear? So this shows that you can avoid the spurious poles on the combined surface, provided you choose your local coordinates at the functions appropriately, so that you have a large suppression for high conformal fields. We have discussed the physical meaning of this. Okay, the physical meaning of this, okay, by scaling these local coordinates, is that we are designing so that most of the contribution to the amplitude comes from a single vortex. Okay, if you are calculating an endpoint amplitude, taking S0 to be large means that most of the contribution to endpoint amplitude comes from just the endpoint vortex. Okay, it's only the contribution that is very close to the boundary, okay, which comes from finite diagrams. Okay, where you have intermediate properties. Okay. And that's all you need, right? Because if you want to regulate the infinite divergences, right, you only need to ensure that the contribution near the boundary are have higher Feynman diagram interpretation. This is easiest to think of this as just a string integral, so that there is only one contribution to the whole set of diagrams. Is this point clear? Okay. I'll explain physically what this is, what this means. Oh, I should have said that for this, you remember that it's important that only a finite number of terms are there below a certain h. Okay? If there are infinite number of states of h equal to 0, then this argument doesn't work. Okay? And as we have discussed, that if you use minus 1 picture vortex of part in the nth sector, okay, then there are only a finite number of states for every below the level. And for Ramon sector, there are infinite number of states at a given Virasoro level. Okay, but once you include the G0, this chi0, only a finite number of states propagate. Okay, so it's essential that you have this G inserted in the propagator. Okay, if the G was not inserted in the propagator, then this whole argument would fail. Okay, and in fact, you can check that unless you have this G inserted, you will get spurious poles. Okay, this is not going to prevent a us in general from encountering spurious poles on the blue surfaces. Is this? Yeah?
There was a fact from the county which said that
Yeah, then you have to put, but you could have put that PCO somewhere there. That wouldn't have worked. Right? In
So then you could have said that this was finite.
Yeah, exactly. Then this, that's exactly the point. Then the fact that this is finite is sort of a guarantee. Yes. Okay, so the general story, in fact, is as follows. Yeah, let's discuss this even. So let's just focus on one side.
Okay.
And suppose y is the coordinate of m, g1, m1. Okay, this is sigma 1. Okay. This is m. Sigma 1 belongs to m, g1, m1. Okay. And suppose there is a spurious pole. Suppose there is a spurious pole at y equal to some point y. Okay, once you have chosen the PCOs, at some point in the moduli space, as you are moving in the moduli space, you may encounter a spurious pole. But of course, you have avoided that. Okay, you have chosen your PCO location so that you never encounter y equal to yz. Now, what happens is the point that once you start this sum, okay, you are inserting more operators here and the corresponding weight factor will be minus SA, S dot HM, right? So, as you insert operators of higher and higher dimension here, the spurious pole location on this surface, of course, doesn't change. But the order of the spurious pole starts increasing. Okay, this you can easily verify. Right? As you have basically, you can take, keep on taking derivatives, right? If there is a spurious pole from y 1 over y minus y naught, as you take derivative with respect to y, the order of the pole goes up. Okay, but the actual pole position doesn't change. So typically what you have is that is the sum of the following form. You have a 1 over y minus y naught to dl. And then the suppression factor gives you something like equal to minus c times l. Okay, because I'm from this factor over here. And so then you have a sum like this. Okay, and roughly, okay, of course the coefficients have to be worked out. Okay. It may not be exactly what I'm writing here, but roughly it will be something like that. So the spurious pole positions will shift. Right? It's not that they don't shift. Once you glue the two demand surfaces together, the spurious pole position in the y coordinate system actually shifts. But that shift can be made as small as you like by taking c to be large. Right? It shifts by 2 minus c. And you can take c to be large by scaling the local coordinates. Right? That c to be large means s not to be large. Okay, that is by scaling the local coordinates. So essentially what happens is that the, once you glue two demand surfaces together, spurious pole shift. But the amount by which it shifts can be made as small as you like by scaling the local coordinates up.
This is a customer, should it be y minus y0 by m minus 1? On the right hand side, if you take y minus y0 common, then you get that series.
Well, it starts, yeah. So let me say with m minus 1, yeah. Yeah, you are saying m minus 1, right? Or m plus 1. M plus 1.
No,
M
minus
1
is in the right hand side.
Oh. See, leading term has to 1 over y minus y 0, right? Yeah, leading term has to 1 over y minus y 0, and then you.
And this is the power minus
1. Yeah, there's minus 1 there. So the idea now is that if your initial choice of PCO locations that you have made here are such that you are always a finite distance ahead from y0, right? You're using your, you have divided up into patches, right? And in each patch you have chosen the PCO locations. But you make sure that that choice is sufficiently far away from those four dimensional two subspaces. Okay, that's what you can always do. And once you have done that, then by increasing c, You can always ensure that you never reach that point. Okay, where the where you would have gotten a spurious singularity. Okay, then you can have a simple by taking C to be large enough. So this basically shows that you can maintain Brillouin compatibility, okay, for avoiding spurious singularities. But what you have to do is that you have to scale the local coordinates by large amount, so that you avoid spurious. Okay, if you don't scale the local coordinates by large amount, and if you choose arbitrary Brillouin, you may run into the problem that after Brillouin you run into encounter spurious singularity. Okay, then this whole idea that you can give a Feynman diagram interpretation breaks down. Okay, you can still give a Feynman diagram interpretation, but it will show up in the following way. That what you find is that in the Feynman diagram interpretation, after you have when you are summing over this, it diverges. That's what will happen, right? If y minus, how will you see this divergence in the expansion? Right? If y plus comes close to y 0 1 plus it to be minus c, right? In this expansion, it will come as in the fact that higher and higher parts are contributing equally. Right? So while the Feynman diagram interpretation is still true, okay, that sum diverges, okay, because there is infinite number of. Is this okay? Okay, so I think I'll stop here. So next time we'll basically come back and go back to the Feynman diagram interpretation. And so what you have seen earlier is that it is possible to reinterpret the string amplitudes as some Feynman diagrams. But now we'll see how to write down a quantum field theory from which those Feynman diagrams form. That you have not so far written down any field theory from the Feynman diagram stuff, right? Just these Feynman diagrams with vortices joined by propagators. But we will say there is indeed an underlying field theory which leads to this.